started playing at Bentley ANA. In fact, I hang around Bentley ANA Cricket Club as a kid of maybe 6 or 7 or 8 for a few years there, where my brothers played, and just couldn't wait to the stage where I was old enough to have a game. I think finally I got a, as a 9-year-old in the under-16s, which was the youngest age group we had in those days. Couldn't wait until, and that was batting number 11 and fielding. Couldn't wait to the year they brought in the under-14s. I think it was about 11 by then, so started to get a bit better. Was actually a wicketkeeper batsman in those days, and managed to make a few runs, and probably didn't have a great technique, but just with having two older brothers, that was really the catalyst for the development of my cricket career, that they were 7 and 10 years older than me, so naturally playing against them, you always are improving because they're older and better than you, and so that got me through, yeah, under 14s. I went to Hyatt eventually and played in the VJCA, played in a senior division premiership there in 71-72 as a 16-year-old, and then off to South Melbourne. Three or four of us mates from the local area all went to South Melbourne in 1972-73. Yes, David, started in the thirds at South Melbourne in 72-73. That was the year Clive Lloyd played for the club, which was pretty interesting, sharing the showers with Big Clive as a 17-year-old. Yeah, I got a few runs in the thirds. I think I only played two games there, just 50s or so. Then got up to the seconds for maybe 4 or 5 games. And then just first game after Christmas, I got into the first, which all seemed pretty smooth sailing. I had a reasonable second half of the year. They looked after me, batting me down at number 6, and I got a few little scores, you know, 30-odd not outs and so on, and I thought, oh well, how long has this been going on? Pretty easy stuff, this district cricket. But then the next year I got a promotion to open the batting, and to be honest, I probably wasn't ready for it. Struggled a bit, went back to the seconds, struggled there as well, and started to question, you know, should I really be here or should I go back to Hyatt? Fortunately, I was really lucky that the coach we had, a fellow named Keith Kendall, who played 287 games for South Melbourne, was the club record holder at the time, and also played quite a few games for Victoria, so he obviously knew what he was talking about, and he really took us under his wing and developed me from perhaps a young kid who had a good eye, his determination, but perhaps not the technique, and he started to develop our technique. Ian Redpath was around the club at that time as well, and always remember Red as saying, well, don't worry about it, you've got two arms and two legs just like anyone else, and no reason why you know, with hard work you can't improve, and see how far you can go. So yeah, it wasn't all smooth sailing. Probably a couple of years later I started to become one of the main batsmen in the team, and 2 or 3 years of pretty productive performances. Got into the state squad, and it took me until I was about 22, I think. First time I ever represented the state was actually in a Sheffield Shield match, so I missed out on all underage teams and Colts teams and everything they had in those days. So yeah, straight into the Shield when I was 22, I think, towards the end of the season. And from memory, the main reason for getting a go at that particular time was there was a West Indies tour, and Graham Yallop, of course, was one of our main batsmen, and he was on that tour, so I basically went up to take his spot while he was off in the West Indies for the last two games of that 77-78 season. Yeah, so we came to that first Sheffield Shield match, and I can actually still vividly remember getting wrapped on the pads, probably almost dead in front. Big LBW shout by Jeff Dimmick, and fortunately the good old Victorian umpire at the other end said, no, I think it was going down leg, but whether he was right or not, I don't know, but I survived that, and from there on, got the nerve to start to play a few shots, and it was a really good batting wicket against Queensland there. They didn't have Tomo, I think he might have been in the West Indies, but they had Jeff Dimmick, Phil Carlson, another fellow named Wayne Shuler, who was a pretty good bowler, and Trevor Hines and Graham White, I think, were their spinners, and I was very, very tentative early. Balls that maybe were in that spot to cut behind point for four, which I'd probably do in a district match. I was patiently letting them go, and then finally, yeah, it's funny the things you can remember, but the first ball that was just sitting there, and I went whack, and it went behind point for four, and sort of bounced back off the picket. So I thought, oh, okay, well, maybe I just got to back myself and go for it. And from there, the runs started to flow, and managed not quite the fairy tale of a century in my first innings, but we were starting to run out of partners at the end, and I managed to get 75 there, so I was pretty happy with that. And the last innings, I think, got to the stage where we needed 268, I reckon, to win. Queensland were going for their first ever Sheffield Shield because it was the second last game of the year. If they'd bowled us out, they probably would have wrapped up the Shield. We did here on that fourth afternoon, where normally the ABC did the coverage from the last session, that the ABC in Queensland had decided to bring forward coverage because they thought the game would probably be over by tea time, because I think we were four wickets down at, before lunch. And anyway, away we went again, and had a pretty good innings. You know, I guess when you're young, your eyes are good, and you probably pick up the ball a bit earlier. I got the confidence from the first innings, and we started to get some partnerships going. As the old wicket went here and there, and we were probably in a fair bit of strife. In fact, I can remember the score at tea time. Dave Watmore was our captain. We were 7 for 134, so we're exactly halfway there. And he said, look, you're going all right. I think it's 20 odd not out or something. And he said, look, just play it as it comes, and you know, go for your shots if they're there. And so away we went. John Douglas was at the other end. Probably better known as a bowler, but he's obviously batting about number 9, and he stuck around with me. He played a very valuable innings of 30 odd, and I don't know what we put on, but over 100 partnership got us well within reach of the target when JD got out, and I was hoping to see us over the line. The second new ball came, and Wayne Shuler, I think, trapped me LBW for 107, but you know, pretty happy to get a century on debut, and would have been nice to get the team over the line, but instead we had to rely on the not very renowned batsman Alan Hurst to get us over the line, and he managed to put a couple with the second new ball back over the bowler's head, and I think they only needed about 10 or 15 for the last wicket, or second last wicket, and they got us over the line, thankfully. So it was a great win, and great at that stage to put Queensland back in their box and deprive them of their first Shield win. So that was it. Yeah, so early in 81-82, I'd had a pretty bad trot, actually, after getting dropped from the state team and not playing any Shield cricket for a couple of years. And it was probably the time in my career, thinking back on it, where the penny dropped from starting to realise that making runs was all about just sticking around, playing within your limitations, and not, you know, getting a quick 30 or 40 and throwing your wicket away. Because I can still remember the first game of the year, we played Ringwood out at Ringwood, and as was often the case in those days with football being played on the grounds, the pitch was really slow and the outfield was really slow, and we were chasing Ringwood's target of 200 odd, but it was actually a lot more than that because of the slow, you know, almost impossible to hit a four along the ground. So that particular day, I used to always have this thing where if I did well in a club match, it made 100, say, that night I'd be that excited and the adrenaline pumping that I could never sleep. So this day, anyway, managed to get us over the line, and I got 100 just before the end of the day's play. And that night, I slept like a baby. And I thought the next day, you know, why, how come I slept well last night when usually I make 100, I'm that excited, I can't sleep. And I thought back on it, and I really didn't play any memorable shots for the day. It was all singles and pushing through a gap for two, barely hit a boundary. And I thought, well, you know, that's what batting's all about. It's just about playing within your limitations and not getting out. And that was really the time. I think I was 26 at that stage, and that was the time when the penny dropped from becoming this guy who would make a stylish, quick 40, 30, and then do something stupid and sit back in the pavilion and watch the guys for the rest of the day and you know, stewing at how stupid you'd been. So from there on, yeah, I think that's really the turning point of my career. And had a pretty good year that year. I think I top scored in almost every innings for the club, and I can't remember, a couple of centuries, and we finished on top of the ladder at the end of the home and away, although we didn't win the premiership. And then, of course, I won the Ryder medal, which perhaps was the catalyst for the Victorian selectors to take note. And I was back in the state squad at that stage, and the following year managed to get back into the state team. Yeah, so then came the opportunity to go to South Africa. I'd had three pretty productive years for Victoria. I think I'd scored nearly 800, then over 1,000 runs, and probably 800 odd in three consecutive years. Didn't seem to be in favour with the Australian selectors, and Graham Yallop actually approached me when four of the original guys who had agreed to go to South Africa pulled out. I think they might have got a bit of pressure put on them from the Nine Network by Kerry Packer, who is rumoured to have done some deals with some of the players, and others had perhaps second thoughts about whether it was the right thing to do going to South Africa. My main motivation, apart from obviously it was pretty good money, I mean, I had a well-paid job anyway, so, you know, the money was some motivation, but to me, the opportunity to play some international cricket, given it was only a squad of 16 players going to South Africa for the 2 years, I'm thinking, well, hopefully going to be a chance to get some international cricket, and would have been very disappointed if I went on two tours without playing an international match. But as it turned out, early on in the tour, one of the first provincial games we played against Orange Free State, and a fellow named Alan Donald was actually playing, I think, his first-class game, and another guy, Corrie Van Seel, who was the opening bowler in the end for South Africa. So I ended up getting 100 in that game, and Kim Hughes started to think, oh, okay, well, maybe this guy's worth giving an opportunity. A few other provincial matches prior to the first test match, and unfortunately, I then had a bit of a rough patch again, missed out a couple of times. The last game, first class game leading into the test match, I managed to run myself out going for a third run, and I thought, oh, I've blown my chance here. Turns out I was picked as 12th man for the first test. There was a one-day game in Durban just a couple of days before the test match, and it got very dewy at night time, and I think three of our guys either tweaked or tore hamstrings on the dewy grass that day, and one of them was Graham Yallop. And, you know, I was good friends with Graham, and he was telling me the day before, you know, they're putting the pressure on me to play, given that he was obviously a bigger name than mine, and they wanted to use his name to promote the match. And he said, look, there's no way I'm going to play. You better get yourself ready. So even though I was announced as 12th man, I pretty well knew I was going to be in the team. And again, I can still remember back to seeing South Africa batting first, and guys like Clive Rice and Kenny McEwen, and of course the great man Graham Pollock, who I'd seen at the MCG 20 odd years earlier as probably an 8 or 9 year old. You know, it was fantastic. I just sort of had to pinch myself to think I'm on the same field playing with Graham Pollock some 20 odd years later, or playing against him. And as it turned out, Graham Pollock smacked us all around, 41 years old, made 108. And I had this sort of vision, or, you know, epiphany, if you like. Geez, wouldn't it be fantastic to make 100 in the same match as Graham Pollock? So, cut a long story short, we got into a bit of strife early. I think I batted number 6, and we were four for not too many. Came in and started to get a few away, battled hard early, and then suddenly everything seemed to click into gear, and ended up playing probably one of the best innings I've ever played in my life. And I don't know whether it was the joy of just getting past Graham Pollock, but when I got to 109, I managed to get myself out. So, but all in all, it was a pretty satisfying first international match. Yeah, obviously it was a fair bit of publicity going around as to whether we should have been going to South Africa or not, and probably the fact that a lot of the guys had contracts with the Australian Cricket Board, which they subsequently had to break. I didn't have that dilemma because I didn't have a contract, but there's always the moral and ethical dilemma of it. To be honest, I don't think we knew as much about what was going on in the country as you would expect at that time. But the one thing I think we gained solace from was the fact that the South African Cricket Board were very much trying to promote equality in cricket, doing a lot of work in townships and so on, and but in the black community and the coloured community. And in fact, there'd been protests where players had walked off the field because they weren't giving opportunities to the majority population of South Africa. So we really looked on it more as an opportunity to go there and play cricket. And I think the fact that we did go, obviously, there was plenty of publicity about it, and kept South Africa in the spotlight. And quite amazingly to us, you know, the whole political system turned around very quickly. And I don't know, if teams didn't go there and they weren't in the spotlight, then maybe it wouldn't have happened as quickly as it did. We got a good chance to look around the country, and you know, even today with the different political system, I'm sure there's a lot of problems there. But from the sporting side, they were obviously delighted to have us there. The fans of South African cricket were starved of international competition at a time when they had some of the best players in the world. So it was pretty sad from that point of view. But they were certainly a very competitive side, equal of any test-playing country at that time, I would suggest, with the calibre of players they had. Some of them well-known to a lot of Australians, but a lot of them who were great players who a lot of Australians wouldn't even know. Guys like Jimmy Cook and, Kenny McEwen came out here, but Clive Rice, obviously well-known, and Graham Pollock. And there were lots of others, Kevin McKenzie. And Dave Richardson. So some of those went on to play test cricket in the end, but for a lot of them, unfortunately, they had very limited international careers. Yeah, so we came back from the South African tour in the February of 1987, it would have been, and then in about the June or July of that year, they announced the Victorian state squad. And I remember they had 38 players announced in the squad, and none of us South African tourists, the four Victorians being Graham Yallop, Rod McCurdy, Rodney Hogg and myself were picked in the state, the initial state squad. Ian Redpath, obviously a former teammate, was the coach, and I gave Redders a ring to see what was going on. You know, they basically decided they weren't going to play us at all, or, you know, what should I do? Because I'd just had a couple of pretty good years over there and felt, I was about 31, 32 years old by that stage, that I could have a few more good years. But I pretty much got the impression that they were ready to move on. They'd played a few younger players while we'd been away for the 2 years, and they said, well, if you get back into district cricket and force your way back in, we haven't ruled out picking you. But it certainly didn't sound like they were too enthusiastic to have us in the team. And in fact, as it turned out, Victoria were the only state in Australia that didn't have a rebel tourist play for them subsequently. Of course, a couple of the tourists went on to play again for Australia, in Kerry Alderman and Carl Rackerman, and Trevor Holmes actually made his debut for Australia back after the rebel tour. So yes, every other state had rebel tourists who subsequently played for them, but none for Victoria. So I headed off to Tasmania. No contracts or anything. I just rang Brian Davison, who I'd known through playing against him in his years with Tassie, and see whether they were interested in me coming down there. So we actually went down there, my wife and I, in July of that year, and met with Dennis Rogers, who subsequently became the chairman of the Australian Cricket Board, and Brian, and they said, yeah, more than happy to have you there, and pretty sure you'll walk straight into the team. So we actually bought a house that weekend and decided to stay in Tassie, which we ended up being there for 7 years. That was the reason behind that. Well, probably the main highlights of my career, hard to go past my first match, but getting a century on debut, and particularly the fact that we got up and knocked off Queensland and stopped them from winning the Shield. So that was certainly a memorable time in my career. The other major highlights are probably Sunday against the West Indies in 84-85 season, and it happened to be the 150th anniversary of Melbourne or Victoria, and I remember the Premier at the time, John Cain, opened the gates at the MCG, I think, for a gold coin donation. You could get in to watch the cricket, and the West Indies obviously were at the height of their game at that time and a very popular team. So we had about 20,000 there at the MCG on the Sunday. The West Indians had batted first and batted for the first 2 days and made something like 580. So it was a pretty good batting wicket. And we went out to bat and ended up getting 100 at the end of that day, which, you know, it was pleasing from the point of view that there was a reasonable sort of crowd there, even though 20,000 at the MCG's not great atmosphere, but better than the usual couple of hundred people we had. And then continued on with the innings and ended up making 234 not out, which was my highest first class score in the end. And we actually ended up beating them on the first inning, scoring over 600. So that was memorable. And then lastly, that getting into the first test when in South Africa when Graham Yallop got injured, and going on to make 100 in what was my first international match. So they were the three highlights. I think my biggest regret, obviously, it would have been nice to play for Australia. Maybe if I hadn't gone to South Africa, I might have got a chance, even though I was 29 years old at the time. But, I think in some ways my biggest regret is not having more confidence in my own ability. You know, I think the thing I found in South Africa was when you were basically, that was the only time in my career where I was a full-time cricketer and didn't have to go off to work. And I think I probably played my best cricket in that first year in South Africa, because you could have a hit every day, you could do as much training as you liked, and you know, maybe if I had backed myself totally and gone to England and things like that instead of worrying about working, I might have developed into a better player. But you know, overall, given I got dropped from the Victorian team after my fifth or sixth game with fairly modest performances, and other guys around that time who got dropped never played for Victoria again, I sort of ended up playing 75 first-class games, got to tour South Africa, and you know, ended up having a pretty healthy first-class career. So whilst I got regrets on some hand, on one hand, and the other, I look back on it and think, well, I probably got most of my ability out there, barring that regret of not becoming perhaps a professional cricketer. Yeah, well, obviously I've been involved with South Melbourne on and off, but mainly on since 1972, and here we are in 2017 and I'm still on the committee at the club, and a lot of things have happened in that time. We had fantastic facilities down at the Lake Oval, then in the mid-90s when Melbourne got the Grand Prix back, we got booted off our ground because of the state government wanting to give the ground to the South Melbourne Hellas soccer team, which, you know, has probably more votes in that than with the given the Greek population of Victoria. So we got shunted down the other end of the lake, made promises of having really good facilities, and to be honest, they were pretty ordinary. It was very difficult dealing with the Parks Victoria, who controlled the ground. Really, they didn't have a great understanding of what was required for Premier Cricket as it had become by that stage, and things like the ground wasn't cut low enough, and we'd be out there mowing the inner circle ourselves just to try and make the conditions more suitable for district cricket. So the time came when we needed to move on, and I was actually vice president and Graham Yallop was the president at the time, and we decided to move out to Cranbourne, which was a huge move after 150 odd years at South Melbourne, so Albert Park. So you know, that's finally starting to bear some fruit, but you know, the club's been great to me. Obviously there's a great history involved in the club with the number of test captains, something like 8 or 9 I think we put claim to now, and something like 100 first class players and 50 odd test players. So it's a club with a great history. I have to say the success hasn't been so great in recent years, and we're looking forward to turning that around out at Cranbourne as the population grows out there. I think before long, in the next decade or so, they project the population is going to be, in City of Casey, is going to be higher than state of Tasmania. So there's got to be a lot of good young cricketers coming out there, and we've got some good coaches there, and great conditions. So all in all, I think it's been a good move for the club, and in years to come they should become a powerhouse, and hopefully justify the decision to go out there. Yeah, I had a reasonable footy career, I suppose. I mean, like most kids of my era, you know, you played footy in winter and cricket in summer, again with older brothers, annoyed the hell out of them to come and kick a football with me, and that all started from probably when I could walk. Really loved both sports, and played junior footy in the city of what was called the Bentley McKinnon Youth Centre, through the Bentley Tigers, and then went to East Brighton for a couple of years, and then Bentley in the Federal League. Played all my underage football through those teams. And eventually, I think I was about 19, a couple of mates had, that I went to school with had gone to play at Caulfield in the VFA. And yeah, I went down there. Tony Jewell was our coach in the first year. I think I started in the seconds and did reasonably well. Wasn't obviously particularly tall, and I wasn't particularly quick over the first 10 metres, but what I could do is run, had good endurance, and I actually found the VFA really suited me. I played in the centre, and of course in those days only 16 players with no wings, so there was plenty of room to run around and really, I guess, take advantage of the one asset. Well, maybe more than one, but the main asset I had, which were my fitness and endurance, and usually managed to rack up quite a few possessions, and eventually got a go in the first, on and off over a few years, in between going to cricket, going to England to play cricket a couple of times. I think I managed to make 50 first division VFA games, which was pretty satisfying, but Caulfield were probably a bit of a battling club, but I mean, it had some really good years in the second division with a couple of premierships, gone back down to up to first division, back down, and then by the time I got there were in first division, and played there for in the first division for 5 or 6 years, I think, and we have mixed success. One of those years was pretty good, where we actually made the finals, and I think we knocked off the top side three times during the year. Three different teams that happened to be on top of the ladder when we played them. I think my most memorable win would have been one day out at Port Melbourne at the North Port Oval, where, you know, it was a bit like going to Victoria Park in the VFL in those days, going out to Port Melbourne on the Sunday. And, we managed to knock Port off by 40-odd points. And, that was a memorable victory, but very enjoyable years at Caulfield. And eventually, when I re-established my place in the Victorian side, I was about a 27-year-old and also started a family. I thought, well, probably time to give away the footy. But it was great that I was able to do both things for so many years, which a lot of sporting people today don't get the chance to do. They've got to focus on one sport or the other. So it was a good outlet to have and to keep fit for cricket.